Not everything metal was created equal.
What an ugly thing to say.
The Metal Sucks Podcast. Chickity Chuck and Godless attempt to bring order to chaos or just make stupid jokes about dumb people.
Stupid. A person below normal intelligence.
This is the Metal Sucks Podcast.
Greetings and salutations, my fine metal friends. Welcome to another edition of the Metal Sucks Podcast. How you doing? I'm Chuck.
I'm Godless.
And this is your weekly examination of all things metal, the Metal Sucks Podcast. You can find us all over the damn place, man, whether it's Stitcher, whether it's iTunes. Just search Metal Sucks Podcast and you will find us, and especially on Mondays at MetalSucks.net. That's where we like to post this sucker. And you can find us, you can dig us up on social media and all that stuff as well. I am at Bearded Ape.
I am at Godless Speaks and GodlessSpeaks.com.
So find us, follow us, tell your friends about it and all that good stuff. This episode, we've got a huge sort of deal. We got Erik Rutan, man. Of course, legendary death metal man who is finally putting out a new Hate Eternal record. I can't. You got to hear this thing.
And you got to hear this interview. It's epic freaking interview. Dude is willing to talk about anything. And it's so, I mean, dude, we went so
we had to stop because we could talk. We could have kept going for like hours. Because, I mean, he's been around for so long. And done so, I mean, it just embedded and plus just produced so many amazing records and so much. I mean, that's just prolific. I mean, amazing stuff. So Metal Sucks Podcast this week brought to you by Creative Live. If you want to learn how to record music, check out our friends over at Creative Live, who have got classes on engineering, mixing, mastering, taught by artists like Between the Bear and Me, Converge, Periphery, Dillinger. Head over to creativelive.com/audio to learn more and watch some free previews and get yourself some damn schooling. All right, we got to get into our interview with Erik Rutan on the Metal Sucks Podcast. Hey, what's up, dude? How you doing? It's Chuck Godless from the Metal Sucks Podcast.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Good, dude. Good. Great to talk to you, man.
Good to talk to you. Sorry I missed your call there.
Oh, no, that's all right. I figured because whenever we call out from, it always shows up like unknown, so I always wind up having to make two or three calls a lot of time.
Unless you're Dave Mustaine, in which case we just give up after a while.
What, is he hard to get on the phone?
Sometimes.
Oh, he's a busy guy, man. He's Dave Mustaine, you know?
Yeah, right.
We call it whenever we have an interview just fall through the cracks, we call it being Mustained.
Yeah. Oh, man, I hear how many guys we got on the line here? Is this fucking party or what? I cursed. I probably shouldn't do that.
You can cuss just fine. It's a podcast.
I can say whatever the fuck I want.
You can.
That's good. That's good to know.
Yeah, no edits needed. It's all good, man.
Erik, how is your hand doing and what happened to it?
Man, my hand, I'd say it's a pain in the ass, but it's really a pain in the hand. But it's been 8 weeks and it's still healing. It's I'd say it's about 70% right now. But I injured my left hand, the pinky and my ring finger were the culprits of the accident. But it's been frustrating. I've been going through therapy and had to regain my flexibility. It's still not completely there yet. It's still painful, but I was loading off stage in Texas, and man, I just slipped on the stairs, and you know, I jammed my rack right into my hand because my sound guy was in front of me, caught me from busting my head on the stairs. But unfortunately, the rack ran into him, and my hand ran into the rack, and man, my whole hand just blew up. Man, it got huge. I went to the emergency room, and I really did not expect. I mean, it hurt like crap. It was a bloody mess, but, you know, I didn't expect it to be 2 months now, and I'm still talking about it. But, you know, it's still healing. I just started playing guitar like 2 weeks ago again because I literally couldn't even bend my fingers halfway to create a fist. So it's been a slow process in doing therapy, but it's doing better. I'd say it's 70% right now, so I'm hoping every day it's getting 1% better. So I'm hoping in a month it'll be healed. But
yeah, right.
Man, what a son of a bitch. It made me realize I got to be a little bit more careful. I'm not the Terminator, even though I feel like it sometimes.
Shouldn't you have like a dude in a tuxedo or like a team of dwarfs who take care of your gear for you at this point?
You know, it's funny. We bring out a sound guy, we bring out a merch guy, and, you know, we could bring a stage guy and this and that, but you know, I never mind loading, unloading gear. I don't mind driving. I don't mind, you know, I don't know, man. I don't ever think about it. I'm a freaking animal, man. So I don't give a shit. I just look at it like militantly, load in, load out, drive. I mean, I drive every single night on tour, man. You know, I'm an animal, man. I just, obviously I'm not Terminator because I got injured. So, you know, but, I don't really mind doing that stuff. Obviously, for almost 10 years in Morbid Angel, I had a guitar tech. I had full stage crew, toured in a bus, and that was awesome, of course. It was the best. But I don't mind hopping in the van and loading gear and driving. Like, I got a good work ethic, man. What do I know? But after this injury, I definitely realized, man, I better be more careful with what the hell I'm doing.
You need an intern.
Yeah, right? Somebody lift something heavy. I'm like, come on.
Yeah.
Well, that's true. Maybe, yeah, you know, I guess we could do contests in every town, like, you know, be a roadie for a day with 80 Eternal, but I don't know how that would work out.
That's a great idea. Instead of doing the VIP package thing, you know, it's like, come on, be our road crew.
I'm not big on the VIP thing because I've been meeting people for 25, 30 years at the merch table, having a beer, loading out at the back, you know, like to each their own, but I never believed in charging fans extra money just to get an autograph or a photo. I'll take an autograph photo with anybody any day of the week, free of charge.
Yeah, but charging money for the chance to schlep your gear, now there's...
Well, you know... well, that'd be a hell of a deal. Listen, you pay us $25 to load our shit. Wow, what a deal.
You know, here's the problem with that, though, right?
The problem is, I'm sure that they'll load, you know, they'll be there for load in. Everything will go smooth. But as the hours go by and the drinks go down, you know, somehow at loadout when you really need them the most, I got a feeling that they might just disappear. You know what I mean? And it's understandable. You're at a show, you're having a good time.
Yeah.
But I think loading would go fine. I think loadout would be a disaster. So, you know, I think we'll just stick to how we got things going on. But I guess I just got to be a little bit more careful.
Yeah, either that or they'll fuck up their your stuff or something like that, you know. They'll be the one to break their hand, and then you're screwed.
No. Better to break my own than theirs, you know. Next thing you know, you got a lawsuit or something. But, you know, I guess we do have people that offer help all the time, though, which is really appreciated. Yeah. Like, people just come out of the woodworks to help constantly, so that's always nice. Unfortunately, that night, man, I'm always just trying to be the... You know, the absolute professional, man. Like, I mean, Glenn from DSI was telling me, like, hey, man, you gotta slow down up there, man. I was like, I'm just trying to get off for them to get on time because I don't want to say by the book, but I mean, I just like to do things professionally. And when my time's done, I want to get the hell off stage on time. I mean, it doesn't matter when you go on, it's when you get off. You got to get off on time. You got to let the guys, DSI's headlining. I wanted to make sure they had the proper time, and I was just running around like an animal, and unfortunately the animal fell. So what can I do?
Well, you're a studio guy, man. I mean, that's what you got to keep that sort of schedule, right? I mean, it's like, it's bam, true. Bam, bam. It's like, it's all part of the deal.
It is. I think a lot of people, man, there's just rules to touring. You know, a lot of people shriek the rules, or they don't know the rules for, because of ignorance, I guess. But, you know, to me, man, I've been touring for 25 years, so I know all the rules. I know the rules as the opener. I know the rules as the local opener. I know the rules as the headliner and everything in between. So I just try to do things the right way on tour, and perpetuate that right way amongst anyone else that's out there. And getting your shit off stage so the headliner can get on is certainly important, you know, and not busting up your hand is important too. So
true.
Well, you're playing with Glenn, and, you know, that's one guy that you got to make sure you follow the rules with, you know?
You know, man, Glenn, let me tell you, like, I've toured with DSI, I don't know how many times, 5, 6 times. I toured with him with Morbid Angel, toured with him with Hate Eternal, shared tour buses. You know, Glenn, he's a great guy, man. I've always got along with him well. I've always had great tours with DSI. I kind of think he gets a bad rap for a lot of things that aren't warranted. And, I mean, I've never had problems with him at all. I've always got along with him great, and I got a tremendous amount of respect for him, and I love DSI. So it was really more just me, my inner clock of like, I gotta hurry. And, or it's kind of the equivalent of like, sometimes I feel like I'm not doing enough. I'm not working hard enough. And then other people say, what are you, you know, out of your mind? I mean, all you do is work constantly. So, it's just my inner clock of like, I gotta be better. I gotta move faster. I gotta work harder. It's just like, you know, it's my internal clock. It never stops, man. What can I say?
Well, we got to talk to, you know, Glenn, like after all that Broken Hope bullshit went down, and he's you're right. He's such a nice guy. You scare the shit out of us, though. I mean, it's still, when he's standing over the top of you with the upside down cross and like get off the stage, I can see it still being a little intimidating, though.
But he's first of all,
a big dude.
You know, he's always been, to me, like one of the best frontmans in death metal. You know, his vocals are killer. Deicide is an awesome band, and I've always enjoyed. I would tour with Deicide any day of the week, man. Any country, any place. You know, I love touring with Deicide, and Glenn's a great guy, man. I really enjoy all those guys.
What kind of went down on that Metal Alliance tour? It seemed from the outside that it just seemed like everything seemed to be from the, before it even began, things were sort of off.
Yeah. I don't know what happened with the whole deal. It definitely had its fair share of issues, as you know, but you know, I don't even have an answer for it. It's like an anomaly or something. I don't even know what the explanation is, but I did have a great time while it lasted, and until I had to, you know, end the last week early due to my stupid hand injury, but I did have a great time. It was great to get out there and do shows with Deicide, and I enjoyed Entombed and all the other bands, and I guess everything in life isn't peaches and cream, you know.
I saw the tour in Austin, and it was right before there was the show. I guess that was the show that you had to cancel right after you hurt yourself, right?
Yeah. When Austin came, we canceled that show, but we were still hanging in Texas. I was really hoping that my hand would, I don't know, I guess
put some ice on it and rub some dirt on it, get back out there kind of thing.
I mean, that was my thought process, because I'm just thinking of canceling anything, to me, is just like, you know, it's not even an answer. But as 2 days went by and my hand was not doing anything, I couldn't even bend my fingers. Well, obviously I realized this was not going to be a walk in the park, and there was 5 shows left. And, you know, I knew that I wasn't going to be able to play, unfortunately, after 2 days. Somehow I just thought that it was going to heal up and be fine in a short period. But, going on 2 months now and still not fully recovered, obviously I miscalculated, but, I just hate it to can't, you know.
Yeah.
I don't like to let people down, man. I don't want to let the fans down. I don't want to let the other bands down, or myself, you know. I mean,
yeah.
I hold myself to the highest of standards above anything or anyone. So, you know, to cancel shows is always just, I came home and I sat there for a week on my couch, just totally not in the best of spirits, you know, like, and then when the week went by and I was supposed to be home, then I felt like, okay, now I can get out of my funk and, you know, try to get some positive healing thoughts going on here. But, yeah, it sucked, but you know, I look forward to getting back on the road and you know, play Austin, of course, man, is a great place to play. And we missed New York and we missed a bunch of shows. It wasn't great, but we'll be out there again.
Well, you got one hell of a record to tour on, man. This new album is badass, dude. I was talking to somebody. I was like, okay, so if you want to like get schooled in what death metal should be, this new Hate Eternal record is a great, great fucking example of it.
Thank you, man. We worked hard, very hard on this record. You know, first of all, we needed to find a new drummer. You know, Jade had left after 6.5 years, and it took us a long time to find the right drummer to play on the record and be a part of it. And me and JJ really utilized that time to hone in on the songs. And we had started a ton of songs, but we really just honed in and crafted these 10 songs, knowing that it was a really, I felt like a great balanced album from Hate Eternal of where I wanted Hate Eternal to be in 2015. You know, it kind of reflects our past, our present, and into the future, I think. And I'm really I'm really pleased from a production aspect, from a songwriting aspect, to the performances, to the tones. I'm never 100% satisfied with anything, but I'm pretty damn pleased with the new record, and I'm glad to know people have seemed to be really excited about it, and that just you know, that just is like icing on the cake, man. But being, I'm my worst critic. It's like, you know, so when people, right. If people, one thing I've had to learn over the years is gaining a hard shell, you know, because, you know, as you know, man, I mean, you know, if you spend your time reading in forums and reading comments, man, you better have some serious self-esteem, man, because it's going to be torn down 10 notches if you don't. But, I've just got a hard shell. So I kind of expect, I always expect the worst, hope for the best. And some people say, man, that's pessimistic. And I say, well, it's more realistic. I'm not an optimist. I'm not a pessimist. I'm a realist. So I know that I expect people to not like what I do. I expect people to hate my guts for no fucking reason. It's okay. I'm totally okay with it. The one thing I do know is that, like, when Infernus, when it was finaled and mastered and done, and I had to proof it the last time, and I had to proof it many times because we did vinyl, we did a high resolution version, we did MFITs for iTunes, we did all these different mastered versions. When I finally listened to it, I knew, I was like, man, we delivered the best we could at this time with everything we did. Can it be better? Everything can always be better, but I knew we delivered the goods. So that certainly, that confidence really helps going into it. So when we start releasing songs, all I can think to myself is like, man, I think this record came out fantastic. I hope everybody else agrees. And when we started releasing songs and seeing people's feedback, man, I was just blown away by how positive the feedback was. And obviously, it just makes everything that you worked on just that much sweeter, you know?
Yeah. Well, and with the trends that are going on in death metal right now, you know, you have a certain expectation, and this just basically said fuck all those trends, and is just relentless. And that's sort of what made it stick in my head, is that it is just from start to finish. Because I had heard, I guess the Stygian Deep is, uh-huh. I'd heard that song by itself, and then I finally got a hold of the record. It's like, oh my god, this is just it doesn't stop.
People, I've had people ask me, like, man, do you worry about certain things, or man, people are very critical of everything you do. And I've had that question before, and I was like, you know, I look at it as a compliment that people hold everything, whether it's me producing or whether it's Hate Eternal, they hold everything in a high regard. And I look at that as a respect thing. And then, you know, once I was able to realize, like, people have such high expectations of everything I do, it's because of the respect level, and that means a lot to me, obviously, and that I do everything I can to, I never want to let anybody down, man. I never want to let myself down. I mean, I spend a lot of time to craft the songs and work together with JJ and Jason and everything I do. If you ask any band that's come in with me as a producer, I'm sure they tell you the same thing, that there's never going to be a time where I'm not working my ass off to make the best possible thing I can. I know there's a lot of, sometimes I always say, wow, man, these, you know, so a lot of people have really high expectations. And I have high expectations of myself. So it works out that way. And I'm just glad when I can release a record like Infernus, where the majority of everyone has been so excited about it. It's just like, wow, man, it just makes it that much better to me. It's just like the bonus, man. It's like, you know, no matter what happens from the release next week, it's like I feel so just pleased with the response so far, and all of us in the band obviously feel very, very pleased with the result.
That communication that sort of happens with you know, between fans and the band, I mean, it's a double-edged sword, but it's so unique in the history of music and entertainment that people have such an influence on the artists that they appreciate and so much access.
You know, at the root of everything, it's like, man, I'm a fan of death metal, man. I'm a fan of Slayer and fucking, you know, and all the other bands that like a lot of people listen to. You know, I grew up listening to metal and then into thrash and then into death metal, you know, so it's like, you know, I guess I've never looked at myself on a pedestal. I'm not better than anybody. I'm not, you know, I'm no different than anyone else, man. You know, it's like, I just happened to somehow make two careers in an industry that it's so goddamn hard to make, to be successful in, you know, to be able to succeed as a musician and also succeed as a producer. I mean, it's been a tremendous amount of work, but man, I also know that, you know, the fans, I don't, you know, it's hard for me to even call people fans. I just feel like, man, they're the listeners of my music or the people that appreciate, you know, the work that I do, you know, it just means so much to me to have that kind of loyalty from people that have followed my career for decades. And I always want to give back to them. And that's why, man, to me, every show I'm usually out there meeting people. If anyone wants to meet me, man, I'm always accessible and have some great conversation. I've made a lot of friends over the years of touring, in all kinds of countries. And, I mean, to me, I really appreciate the people so much because it's because of them that I'm here. I mean, I wouldn't be touring. I wouldn't be doing records if nobody gave a shit. I could be the best guitar player, producer in the world, but if I'm just playing to myself and producing my own shit that nobody hears and nobody supports, then what does it all mean at the end of the day? So, you know, to me, I think that correlation is so important. Nowadays with social media and stuff, it's obviously a different world of criticism and stuff from other people. But I also realize, you know, a lot of the criticism or stuff that comes is people that aren't even fans. They didn't have a vessel to explain these things. And, you know, people have, you know, some people are, I guess, internet tough guys, man. You know, they go online, they talk. You know, back in my day, 25 years ago when I first started and there was no internet, you know, people didn't really talk that ton of shit because, you know,
If they did, it was outside by the bus and they'd get their ass handed to them.
Hey, I grew up in Jersey, man. So, you know, I mean, listen, repercussions certainly were associated with your actions, where now, you know, there are no repercussions for online assaults. So, you know, but that's okay, man. You know, like I actually find, man, I personally find some of the stuff online. Sometimes I read stuff. I just think it's humorous as fuck, and even at my own expense. So, like, I have a good sense of humor about things, man. I take what I do very seriously, but I don't take what I do too seriously. Or if that makes sense, you know what I mean? Like, you can't. If I got butt hurt by every negative comment made about me, well, man, I would have never lasted this long. So, you know, I do find it hilarious sometimes. Some of the things I read online, I just think are freaking hilarious.
Yeah, you can never leave the house. You'd be, I can't take it anymore. Yeah, you gotta have a thick skin, you know?
We recently spoke with Mirker, the black metal one female performer. I'm not sure if you're familiar with her stuff, but
no,
she was talking about how she gets notes that I guess no male musician could probably ever get because it's stuff like, oh, I looked at every single frame of your video and
you're a stupid whore
God.
And where it's so it's like, I think that, like, you know, for a lot of people it's like, you know, fuck them. But then there's stuff where it's scary.
that is scary. I've had a few. I don't think I've had anything like that. But you know, once in a while, I've had some, I guess, some freaky shit happen. But I guess I guess that's what comes with it, right? You got this interaction with people. There's always going to be some kind of freaks, I guess, that pop out of the woodworks. But you know, also because of social media, man, I've had some really inspiring moments of people sending messages about, you know, how this song inspired me to do this, or I've had people contact. I had someone contact me that one of the songs I wrote for my old bass player that passed away, Jared Anderson. He played for his best friend at his funeral, and you know, I thought, wow, you know, sometimes you get these people that you meet, and they tell you these things online, or I've met, you know, a drug addict that decided to quit drugs because he had sent me a message on Facebook, and I just took the time to send a message back, you know, to give him some positive reinforcement, you know, to get his act together, and you know, that's where these things. I've met people in the military that listen to a certain song that inspired them to get through being overseas, stuff like that, man. I mean, like, how do you put you can't put a price tag on that kind of stuff either, man. It's just that.
Yeah,
is
yeah,
just amazing stuff.
Tell us more about the freaks.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, man, I don't even want to get into it because I'm worried I might have some backlash, man. And the next thing you know, they're going to track me down. And hey, listen, you never know, man.
But you're shutting down the Twitter account and then having a, oh, damn it, not again.
Well, you know, the good thing is I live in Florida. And Florida is a state that, you know, they're
stand your ground
law, very gun friendly, unlike my home state of New Jersey. But so, you know, I'm ready.
So you're saying you're packing is what you're saying. Okay.
Hey, right. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying, like, hey, if when I moved to Florida, man, one of the first things I ever did was go to a gun show, and I was just in awe. I was very amazed coming from New Jersey, where, like, man, even to get a rifle for hunting is difficult. You know, you go to Florida and I'm looking at Tech Nines. You know, it was definitely a change of pace, but
I think it's appropriate at this point that you tell everybody that your trigger finger is on your right hand and not your left.
Yeah. Well, actually my trigger finger on my left hand's working just fine. That one didn't get injured. So I am pretty ambidextrous. So, you know, hey, take my right hand out. I'm still packing with the left, so, you know, man, what can I say?
So, I mean, are you a big gun guy? I mean, do you shoot a bunch, or?
You know, man, I don't have time to do much besides produce and play music and hang out with my wife. And I mean, I work so much, you know, that I don't get to go to the gun range. But I do like guns. Yeah, I certainly have a few as well. My wife shoots guns also, so. Man, nothing says love more than a wife that buys you a 45, and in return, I buy a nice 9mm for her. Merry Christmas, honey. You know, that's true love right there.
Exactly. That's because you know what? I trust you not to shoot me in the face.
Well, okay, so either or, right? So which person that you meet up with would you rather have your gun for protection? Would you rather have it for one of the trolls on Facebook or something, some social network, or Pete Sandoval?
Oh, man. Well, Pete is one of the most harmless guys on the planet. He's an awesome dude. He's one of my best friends. So
He doesn't scare you at all?
Nah. He don't scare me, man. He's a great guy, man. He's one of the nicest guys on the planet. So he's like family to me. So I'm not worried about. And honestly, the internet trolls, which I'm not even sure I know the terminology of what a troll is, unless we're talking like, you know, some hobbit type shit or something. But I'm not worried about that either, man.
Does Pete get upset when you send him a Christmas card and it doesn't have a religious connotation to it?
Well, first of all, I don't send Christmas cards, so I guess, you know, but I just saw Pete recently, man. So, you know, he's on his own page for sure these days, but, you know, he's harmless, and he's an amazing person. So, you know, I don't have any problems with Pete at all, if anything.
Does he still play, or is he just doing striper covers, or what?
Nah, man, I don't think he's doing, what is that? Hell with the Devil. I don't think he's doing any stretch covers, but you know, he's doing Terrorizer. He's doing. When I saw him, he's doing great. He's still playing drums, and you know, man, to each their own. He's still the same guy. He's just you know, gone on a different path, but he's still.
I would kill to see video of him in his mega church doing a blast beat you know, like with the Sunday band, you know?
Well, that'd be impressive. Yeah, I would actually like to see that myself, but yeah. he would tear that place apart for sure, man. He's still, people forget Pete Sandoval, man, the king of the blast, man. He cannot understate how important Pete Sandoval is to the art of death metal drumming. So, you know,
there's that great story about how he had never done double bass drum like 2 weeks before they recorded Altars of Madness, which is like freaking crazy to imagine, you know?
I think it was more like 6 months, but you know, still, part of that is true. Obviously you can imagine I played in a band with Pete and Trey and Dave and Steve, you know, for years. So I have a lot of stories, of course, but, that story is true. I think 6 months before Altars, he didn't play double bass. Terrorizer didn't have any double bass stuff. So he did learn. And I remember Trey would tell me stories that, you know, Pete would be practicing in the basement that they had at the house that they all lived in. And one time he would come down there and Pete would like just be passed down on the floor, you know, because he would just play and play. I mean, when I first came down to play with Morbid Angel, I remember, you know, Florida, hot as shit. And we practiced in the Ustor facility, which anyone that's down from the Tampa area would know that place because everybody practiced there at some point. And I remember walking in, you know, and hot as shit, you know, it's like May or June, and it's like probably 120 degrees in there and no air conditioner, nothing. And that, you know, I remember asking Pete, I was like, man, don't you get hot in here? It's like, fuck that, you know, that shit. Air conditioner for fucking pussies, man. I don't need that shit. And you know, I remember he would just be like, he would just practice. We would practice for hours and hours and hours, man. And he would just sweat his ass off. And he would just, you'd look like he just took a swim in a sweat pool. And he'd totally be fine because he was just a badass, period. He, man, that dude is don't mess with Pete Sandoval, man. Don't mess with him.
So can you address the rumor that you've rejoined Morbid Angel?
Wow, that's new news to me, but I haven't rejoined Morbid, but I do love Morbid Angel, man. I admit, I always tell people that if I could clone myself, I'd still be there because I do love the band. I always have, always will. And certainly, I never say no to anything, man. I mean, I would never close the door on Morbid Angel. Man, I'd never close the door on Ripping Course, man. I mean, I'd never close the door on anything that I've musically been a part of because I'm proud of everything I've done. And, but right now, man, between releasing Infernus next week and touring Hate Eternal and, producing, obviously I've got a pretty full plate, but I never say never, never say never to anything, man.
It seems like the timing might work out pretty well.
Well, I mean,
probably a few months away, right?
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, I've been producing Steve Tucker's band Warfather as of the last few weeks. I'm mixing it right now, actually. So I do talk to Steve a lot. Been working with him, and I talk to Trey a lot. I mean, Trey lives not far from me, and we keep in touch. I like to keep in touch with everybody, you know, I played in the band with. I think it's important.
Yeah, especially if you once received a check from them.
Well, you know, I mean, like, first of all, the fact that you receive any checks in music is a
miracle.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, I was sitting here the other day thinking, like, wow, I've been doing music between producing and playing guitar. I mean, I've been doing it for a living for a long, long time. And then, man, to me, that's just a miracle in this day and age of the music industry and where things are at. It's so hard to make it, but I'm a multitasker, man. You know, I do multiple things, or maybe somebody say I'm ADD, OCD. Just add a D to it. I got it all. But you know, the thing is if you want to make it in music, you just got to go forward and never look back and just work your ass off. And, I feel very grateful that I've been able to make a living doing this for a long time. And, it's getting harder and harder for bands, I think, especially newer bands with the way that things are and album budgets and album sales declining, and then everyone's touring, you know, now to make money. And, you know, there's just like a million tours, a million shows, you know, every week. And it's getting tough out there for sure. You got to be real creative and you got to work hard in order to make it. And just know that if you get into music, it all could, you better have the passion and the love for music. If you're getting into music thinking you're going to make a ton of money, boy, you're sorely mistaken.
Yeah, right. Well, and you've got you basically got three records that are coming out that you've touched this month alone, right?
Like Chrissian, dude, what a month.
Yeah, right. It's what, Chrissian, Blackfast, and then the Hate Eternal, obviously.
Yeah.
But what I was thinking about when I was looking at that, going, so you got Chrissian, who's been around for a while, Hate Eternal, obviously, for a while, and then Blackfast, fairly new. I was like, which is your preference? Do you like working with the newer bands, or do you like trying to breathe new life into the older stuff as far as producing and recording, or is it just a little bit of everything?
You know, it's funny because there's pluses and minuses to all of it. You know, it's like, but it's really mostly just pluses. Working with newer bands, younger bands, I feel is rewarding in the sense of, like, a lot of the guys that come in, they're like sponges, man, you know, and they just have, like, they just want to soak in every bit of information they can and learn, or they wouldn't be here. You know, I think my reputation is kind of out there, and you know, people have perpetuated that reputation as being a drill sergeant and being hard in the studio. And that's because I expect the best from people I work with. I don't give a shit if it's your first record or your 10th record. I'm going to do everything I can to get the best out of you, to get the best performances and the best everything. And that's how I look at everything. And with younger bands, a lot of times they really look forward to that experience to learn. So like working with Blackfest, for instance, you know, younger guys, but man, it was incredible to work with them. They were really talented musicians, and the key to working on a record together is the chemistry. You know, it's like, if you don't have that chemistry in there and you're not on the same page and open-minded to everything, you're limiting yourself. And the most important thing, I think, in the studio is chemistry between the producer and the band, and everything being laid on the table. Now, when you get the chance to work with a band like Chrissian, who I've worked before with, I've known him for almost 20 years, or say Cannibal Corpse or Goat Whore. Goat Whore, I did 5 records. You know, Cannibal Corpse, I did 3 records. I mean, or 4 records would go to, excuse me. And, you know, you work with bands over and over again, the vets, well, everything really is on the table because there's no holds barred, man. You know, it's like, you know, they've been doing it for a long time. So have you. And it, the more records you do with somebody, the more you're able to really, push the limits because you don't have to worry about anything. Like, if somebody thinks the guitar sound sucks, they're going to tell you, and I'm going to say, all right, next. I don't sit there and cry about it. You just move on and keep working to get the best results. So there's pluses with working with the vets, obviously, because they've been doing it. There's also pluses with the young guys because they haven't been doing it, and they want to learn. And I always felt like part of my job is teaching people everything I can. Every bit of knowledge I have, I want to teach to anyone. Anyone that wants to know, yeah, man, I'm more than welcome to teach them. If they don't want to know and they don't want to learn, well, the minute you sit there and think you know everything is the minute that you stop progressing, you know, as a human being. So I always know I can, you know, I still have the best in me. I have much better to do, and I want to keep working harder to get better at everything I do. And there's so much more to learn. If you don't have that mentality, then you're just limiting your productivity as well as the results.
I was going to say, do you take it personally when a band that you've done albums with then goes with a different producer for their next album?
You know, it's, I wouldn't say personally would be the word, because there's a lot of great producers out there. You know, there's a lot of great engineers that do fantastic jobs. I think that I look at it in the way of, like, you know what? I like Starbucks, you know, I like other coffee. I like Caribou Coffee. I like, Seattle's Best. I even like Dunkin' Donuts, man. They're 4 different brands. You know, that doesn't mean that because I drink, you know, Dunkin' Donuts one day that all of a sudden I think Starbucks sucks, or that, you know, I know it's a weird analogy, but sometimes you say, wow, I'm surprised that they're not coming back, or but a lot of times when, you know, I have a lot of, you know, my communication with every band I work with is always very open. So when bands decide to go somewhere else, it's usually there's always a reason behind it. And the reasons are logical. You know, sometimes people want to change. They want a different approach. I do things very differently than I think most in metal, for sure. It's like, you know, and some people want to change a pace. They want a more modern sound, or they don't want to leave their where they live to come to Florida and things like that. So, you know, it's always understandable.
Do you ever listen to like that next album by that other producer with like a notebook?
I was thinking the same thing. I was like, God, do you ever just like pick it apart? It's like,
yeah, when you're going, and then just send a little brief email. Hey guys,
that drum tone, that drum sound was awful. Yeah,
not
like,
saying
what the
nothing.
Fuck happened there? I know that's fake as shit. No, I don't do that, man. But I do. I mean, the thing is, man, the way I do things is unique, man. I try to make every record sound unique. I try to get the best out of people. I don't let studio magic dictate how that record comes out, because that's pussy shit. I don't have time for that. I don't have time for, you know, me personally, I'll speak for myself. I just like to make musicians. I like to get the best out of them. And I use Pro Tools and I use whatever, but still I try to treat Pro Tools almost similar to how I would record the tape back in the day, is that I really try to capture the magic from the musicians themselves. And I think at the end of the day, the musician is going to feel a hell of a lot better about themselves rather than me punching note by note or quantizing the drums to sound like a drum machine. Oh, what's the point? I'll just fucking use Superior Drummer, put some samples on there, and save everybody a bunch of time. Drummer can go to the beach and have a beer. So I got to think that for me, and this is me speaking, obviously I'm probably in the minority here, but that minority has also made me a career, and that's because people that come here, they want a unique sound. They want to get worked hard. They don't want to take the easy route. They want to, if at the end of the day, I know I got the best out of everybody and they gave their best, and that's what, to me, that goes so far in how, you know, how you feel about your record, how you feel about everything. And, the best records in my lifetime and prior to my lifetime were made that way, with passion and hard work and ethic and not taking the easy way out. And I've never taken the easy way out in anything. So, but when it comes to, I respect other producers and I respect a lot of modern records as well. I just choose to do things a little bit differently. And when bands, but I've never done anything like that. You're like, I don't criticize. I'm just not a guy to criticize other people's hard work, man, because I know that people do things differently. And does that mean I want to do things the same way? No, but I certainly respect everybody's differences in how they do things, you know?
Has there ever been like a band that got away that when you sat down at the dinner table and told the wife, she really, really got pissed off about it?
Oh man, I'm not even gonna go there, man. I'm not gonna go there. But I wouldn't say pissed, you know. My wife is my number one supporter.
Yeah, I can picture her being like, you know, hey, you know, we cooked them dinner, or I came over, we did all this stuff for them, and then, yeah.
Well, you know, my wife is my number one supporter, so she's definitely going to, she's going to take my back on anything, that's for sure, man. But, it's hard, probably, when somebody decides to go somewhere else, of course, you know, you're human, so you're disappointed, or, you know, but at the same time, this is how I look at records, and this has helped me, just like it helps me with criticism and stuff like that and building a shell, is that I look at every record as a unique entity. So every record I do, I know that could be my only one with that band or my last one. You know, with Cannibal Corpse, you know, when I did the first record, when I did Kill, I looked at that record as a one-time chance, man. This is my shot. Either I, you know, blowing it is not an option. I need to make it be killer. No ifs or buts about it. And, but I didn't look at it past that, you know, because I knew, listen, Cannibal Corpse can work with anybody they want. I'm fortunate enough that I got to work with them for this record, make the best of it. I can't worry about what happens past it. Next thing you know, I ended up doing the next one, and then I did the next. I did three records with them, so it was already a 300% improvement of what I thought was possible because I look at things that way. And it also helps me when, you know, if I treat every record individually, then it really helps my focus on that album. It also helps me, I don't know, if the band does decide, like in Cannibal Corpse, they decided to work with Mark Lewis. Well, it, you know, it helps me to really reflect, and instead of feeling like, oh, this way or that way, all I do is feel like, man, I'm fortunate and grateful that I got to do three badass Cannibal Corpse records. And I guess that's how I look at it, rather than being upset. You know, I mean, that's not going to do anything. I mean, Mark does a fantastic job. He does things very different, and they wanted to try a different approach. And I certainly respect that and grateful for the three records I did get to do with him, you know?
Hell yeah. Despite the fact that the new album doesn't sound as good, right?
No, man, the new album sounds great, man. You know, different strokes for different folks, man. You know, but Mark Lewis is a pro. He does a fantastic job, no doubt about it.
Well, dude, congratulations on Infernus, man. I think that work ethic has paid off for sure on this one, and hopefully those fingers will get cured here soon, and we get you on the road again.
Yeah, man. They're better.
Chuck, can I ask Eric real quick before he goes, though? So, yep. Eric, is there any chance that you're going to need to get somebody to play guitar on your upcoming tours and you just sing?
Well, man, my life would be much easier if I could just have somebody else play guitar and be a singer. That'd be pretty cool, man.
And schlep your gear.
No, man, fuck that. If I'm the singer, I don't move gear, man.
That's right. It's a microphone. Yeah. That's it. Done.
I don't even know if I'd own a microphone. Fuck it, man. I just go, you know, rogue or something. But, you know, like, to be a singer would be pretty cool. I'm a guitar player first, man, so I don't see that ever happening. But please, don't hex me, man. I need to keep my fucked up half-ass fingers crossed, so I don't have to deal with that. But
as a self-employed guy, right, when you have something, when you got to go to an emergency room, that's freaking scary because of the financial considerations. How did that all work out for you? And, you know, now that you've kind of seen the inside of the U.S. health insurance and all that, from your point of view, what's your perspective on it?
Well, you know, luckily for me, my wife has a job for a nonprofit organization that has amazing health insurance. So, I'm very fortunate in that. But before that, I've been paying for health insurance since I was in my mid 20s, just because, you know, it seemed like the smart thing to do. Better have health insurance in case something happens. I mean, it's just kind of, I've always paid for health insurance. So I've never, I don't know. I'm definitely not the brightest star in the sky, but I just, health insurance with all the traveling and everything I do, it always just seemed like something I should invest, whatever I pay a month, you know, to have. And I'm glad I have over the years, because I've been in a van accident. I've had this accident. I've had many accidents. If I did not have health insurance, I would have been totally fucked. In this case, unfortunately, the place I went was out of territory, so I had to pay a bunch of money, or out of network, excuse me. But at the end of the day, the one thing I always say to people is like, man, I've always paid for, and now with Obamacare and stuff, from what I'm told, which I don't know because I don't have it, but I'm told that Obamacare is actually more expensive than what they were paying before Obamacare. So I don't know if the approach on socialized kind of medicine has worked at this point. I don't know, because I'm not a part of it. You know, like I said, I have health insurance, but health insurance, it's a tricky thing. I think, you know, it's my old drummer, you know, lives in Canada. Obviously they have socialized medicine up there, and I think that there's a lot of good aspects from it, but then Jade would also tell me that, you know, when you would need a surgery or something, you'd be on a waiting list for 16 months or 12 months, and So there's, I guess there's flaws in every system, yeah. right? Nothing's perfect, but I think health insurance, man, you got to have health insurance in this day and age in some capacity, or else you're setting yourself up for some serious issues down the road, you know?
Yeah, no, it's scary. The Bruce Corbett from Rigor Mortis, just went through heart surgery, and you know he's basically having to do like a GoFundMe for it. Oh. It's like, you know, and it's like, oh,
so
man,
sad.
You got something going on with like a roadie, somebody that you've worked with who's had a back problems, and there was a GoFundMe on your Facebook, I think it was.
Yeah, my sound guy Anthony, a friend of his, unbeknownst to Anthony, you know, which he was like, not. He never wanted to do that route, but his friend did it for him because he knew that he had back injury and he didn't have insurance. And yeah, he fell off a, you know, he does sound and he does rigging and things like that, but at home when he's not on tour, and he fell on his back and, I think broke his couple vertebrae. He's doing better. He still can't lift, but he's, you know, he's doing okay, but he had thousands and thousands of dollars of medical bills. I feel for, man, people, and I always tell people like, shit, health insurance is expensive, but if you don't have it, it's going to be a hell of a lot worse. So I've just kind of always, and maybe that's been instilled from my mother, you know, like from, I don't know how long I can remember. It's just like health insurance is important. It's important. It's kind of been instilled in me. And somehow I've been a responsible adult about having health insurance. I have no idea how that's possible, how I even turned into a responsible adult in the fucking first place. But, you know, health insurance, man, it's when you don't have it, you'll wish you had it.
Yep.
And when you have to pay for it, you wish you didn't have to pay for it. So it's like a, you know, conundrum, man. Yeah. But
Hate Eternal Walking Wounded Tour 2015.
Yeah, listen, man, the amount of wounds I've had over the years, man, I've you know, I've broken my leg. I had a tumor in my leg when I was a kid. I had to get removed. I've broken fingers. I broke my wrist. You know, man, I had to, van accident, I cracked my vertebrae, and man, I've had tons of shit. And luckily for me, not going, anytime I've thought about canceling my health insurance, something, it's almost like karma, man. It's like, you know, something wakes you up and says, hey, hold on to that, you'll need it. And sure enough, I've had many things that I've needed it for. So my suggestion to all musicians is, get the Obamacare, get the health insurance, protect yourself, man. That's all I can say.
Damn straight. Well, dude, it's been great talking to you, man. It really has.
Thank you, Eric. We could go a couple more hours.
I know, really good.
Come on. I got like three more pages of questions here.
And then people are going to be like, man, what the fuck? Why is this 3 hours, man?
Yeah, but they're going to be like, why didn't he ask about this? Why didn't he ask? Why are you such a
man?
He didn't ask about that. You know, that's
see, you're going to get the criticism this time.
Trust me, we do.
Yeah, it always happens.
They're going to be like, these fucking metal truck guys, why didn't they ask him about this or that or this or that? I mean, what the fuck are they doing, man?
That just means we'll have to have you back on, so.
Well, since Zakk Wylde won't do it, when are you going to reunite Pantera?
Oh, no, man. No. That's you know, that's, I'm not even going on that conversation. Because
every metal interview ever has to ask about when Pantera is going to unite, man.
Chuck, he's played with Pantera, man.
That's right.
I've seen the video.
Listen, I played Walk with Pantera, which was, you know, obviously one of the most amazing experiences of my life. First of all, the fact that we toured with Pantera twice, 16 weeks of touring, in arenas, it was like, man, I felt like I was fucking Mark Wahlberg in Rockstar or some shit. You know, like you're some kid in Jersey hoping to play shitholes and any place that will have you, and maybe scrub together a living someday. You're playing death metal, you know, that's your dream. And then one day you're playing fucking Nassau Coliseum and First Union Center and all these places, the opening for Pantera. It was pretty much unreal, you know. And to play with Dimebag, and I mean, you know, it was fucking incredible. It's some of the most amazing experience of my life. And I think I totally, the Pantera thing's tough because, man, I mean, Dimebag, man, he was such a integral part of Pantera, and his loss was such a tragedy. And I don't I don't know if that, I don't, you know, obviously that's up to Vinny and, you know, and Rex and Phil, but I don't know. I don't think that, I don't think a Pantera reunion will ever happen, man. I mean, in my opinion, I don't think so, because the one guy that would complete that reunion is not with us anymore, man. So I don't see it ever happening, in my opinion, but who knows? I could be wrong. Time will tell, I guess.
I thought you were an optimist.
Hey, realist, remember realist.
Yeah, right.
Not I am a pretty positive guy these days, I guess, you know, when you're doing everything you want to do, since you're like, you know, you're some 14, 15 year old kid in your bedroom hoping, man, someday I'm going to have a band and tour the world and maybe I'll have my own studio and maybe I can record my buddy's band down the street, you know, that's, and then all of a sudden here I am 25 years later doing everything plus times 10 that I could have possibly hoped for, man. I guess I don't have any room for complaints, do I?